Hi, I'm Yannick Wasdalis, VideoBasedLessons.tv, and we are talking about transcribing. We're taking a quick look over these few free videos. We're taking a quick look inside our brand new transcription course, a 12-week long course at VideoBasedLessons.tv. We're looking at Michael Brecker saxophone transcription, and we're looking at how that material can work for us and work on any instrument. You don't have to be a bass player watching this. I'm a musician who just happens to play the bass, and we happen to be working on this transcription using the bass. Now, in the previous video, we talked about the planning, why I was drawn towards this particular transcription or this solo, and why I'm drawn to any of the things that I choose to go and work on and transcribe. And in this video, we're looking at the second part of the course, a brief look at the second part of this transcription course, which is writing the music down, making some sort of record of it. Now, anyone who knows me knows that I'm a tech geek. I love things that make our life more streamlined and faster and easier, and handheld devices and devices that do that and devices that do this. But when it comes to transcription, you couldn't really get more old school. Like pencil, eraser, and a real old notebook, like a real manuscript book, full of dots on lines. And this is basically my entire scene right here. I have dozens of these books, manuscript books, full of transcriptions, just like the one we're working on right now. So this is my process. I want to give you a quick look inside that. I shot some video while I was in the process of transcribing this solo. It was quite a challenging task. Even though I've been doing this for 15 years, there were still some things that I had to kind of scratch my head over and say, wow, what is that exactly? So check it out. Take a look at me. I don't actually transcribe the stuff at the bass. I sit there at a keyboard. I used to use a cassette player with the buttons on it, you know, with the record and the pause, the play, the fast forward, the rewind. And if you looked along the row of buttons on my cassette player, the rewind button was about a half an inch lower than all of the others, even when it wasn't pressed in. And that was because all I did was put the cassette tape in and rewind, play, rewind, play, rewind, play. So what I'm doing now, as you'll see in the next video clip, is I'm doing kind of an updated version of that. I put the song, the MP3, into a Logic session. I'm just rewinding it and rewinding it and listening to it. I'm not slowing it down. I've never been a fan of slowing the stuff down. Everyone's different. If you have the technology to do that, and if you think it benefits your playing and your process, then by all means go ahead. I really like to train my ear as much as possible and never slow things down. I will repeat very, very short phrases, maybe 2, 3, or 4 note phrases if it's going by really fast. Excuse me, and I need to hear that over and over again, but I'll never actually slow stuff down. So check out a little bit of me in my little home studio with the keyboard, transcribing this Michael Brecker solo.
Good for my ear training, my ability to sing this stuff as well. So I'll just move to that next phrase. Hey. I've been doing this for 15 years and I'm still not that good at it. So basically, I guess the thing that plays through my head all the time is, you know, one bar at a time, even some one note at a time, like this, when I'm singing one note, playing another, or vice versa. Glad the space bar on my keyboard is already this low. It can't really get any lower, but this is the one that's seeing the most action. The basically it's an all-in-one rewind and play. Okay, so okay.
Okay, so there you see me sweating a little bit, trying to get a particular phrase of the solo down. I wanted to show you that because we're all human, and you know, no matter how long you've been doing that, at least I felt, I sat there thinking after, actually right after that clip, I thought, wow, it's not like I haven't played these notes before. I haven't played them in this particular combination, but I have played phrases that contain, you know, I've played phrases that contain a major triad, or augmented triad in this case. It's kind of a D-flat augmented triad. You know, these are not new harmonic concepts to me in terms of stuff I've covered before. So just the fact that it was in a slightly different combination, the phrasing was slightly different, was a real genuine challenge for me to get to kind of assimilate and to get that down on my trusty 14th century notepad here. And I just want to highlight the fact that nobody gets this stuff immediately. Nobody writes it down on the first time they listen to it. And even someone like me who's been doing this for years and years and years still has a few issues here and there in terms of transcribing this stuff and writing it down. So I would say very important not to get too stressed out about it. And also I should say that I did this transcription over the period of a few days. Bear in mind, it's only about a minute and a half of music, I think, and only seven choruses of a blues. So I kind of set myself, all right, I'm going to do a chorus. Let's see how that goes. Okay, it didn't go so badly. I actually think I did two choruses in the first sitting. Then I took a break and I stepped away from it, which was really healthy and is really healthy throughout the process. I found, especially when we get to the next video, when we talk about the playing side of things, I found that taking a break has been, you know, one of the biggest assets I could ever have. Just knowing, okay, I'm not making any headway. I'm not going to force myself to learn more or write more or understand more right now. I'm okay where I am. I'm going to take a break. Maybe I'll come back tomorrow and check it out. So don't ever lose sight of that as an option. You can always take a break. You can always put it off for a couple of hours or a day and come back to it when you're fresh and you're really a lot more into feeling like getting that information inside you. So part of the writing the stuff down process involves hearing a lot of quite often familiar shapes. Like if you take the very first seven notes, the kind of the opening line, the leading line into the top of the form of the entire solo. We have three notes from what I kind of hear as an F7 sound. We have the three, the natural three, the flat seven, and the nine of an F7 chord. And then we have a really basic 1, 3, 5, flat seven, minor seven arpeggio, if you like, in C. Now, if you've seen any of my other lessons before, I've talked a lot about chord tones. You've probably studied chord tones before. You've probably heard the phrase chord tones. And you'll notice throughout this entire solo, if you really look into it, a lot of these shapes are going to be very familiar. There are going to be some quirky ones and angular things that you've never thought of or heard before or don't fully understand immediately. But so much of this stuff is going to be common language. It's like the way we use the words and if and but and to and hello and goodbye, all these really common words that you don't even think about. You know, most of the language we speak, we don't even have to think about it to get it out of our mouths and to make ourselves understood. So a lot of this music you're going to find is going to be these huge lines and these flurries and these things that seem incomprehensible when you first hear them. When you stop and really listen and go piece by piece, you're going to find a lot of very familiar shapes in the music. Now, you're hearing these familiar shapes and over and over again, that can be a great thing because they're familiar shapes and you can be, oh, that's a -7 arpeggio, fantastic. There's also a trap, and one that I fall into all the time, is you'll start to kind of get ahead of yourself and you'll be like, oh, that's just that. And you'll listen to it a couple of times and you'll think, oh, that's just a -7 arpeggio. And then when you really go back and listen to it, maybe it wasn't a -7 arpeggio. Maybe it was just a very small variation on that shape that you're used to listening to, but it's that small variation, it's those details that really, to me, that's where the learning happens. You know, when we get outside of those familiar shapes and we start learning new information and new ways to put these kind of rough familiar shapes together that somebody else, like Michael Brecker in this case, has spent his life doing. That's his unique sound. And to dig into that and to really find those details is super important. So in the terms of the writing it down phase of the transcription, I would say that repeat listening over and over and over and over and over again, really double checking your work, identifying common phrases, which are great, but also not falling into the trap of thinking it's a common phrase or shape and then just writing that down and moving on to the next thing. Don't ever rush it. There is no rush. There really isn't. You know, I used to take weeks over some of these because my ear just wasn't trained enough and it was okay. I felt okay with that. I was like, okay, this is the pace I'm working at. I'm totally cool with that. And I want you to feel that way too. You don't have to work at breakneck speed. You don't have to force yourself to learn this information immediately. It's not going to come immediately. It does take time. And I want you to know you have time. You have all the time in the world. And we're going to get to the next, I guess, the fun part, or one of the I guess everyone's waiting for, the actual playing of the notes. You heard a little bit of that in the last video. We're going to really look at my process, quick look inside my process, and a look inside this transcription course, this 12-week transcription course on videobasedlessons.tv. The next video is going to look at the playing aspect and some of the details, some of the secrets, some of the tips I have for getting this information into your playing and getting it fluid and getting it natural. I'm Yannick Guzdala, it's videobasedlessons.tv, and we'll see you again on the next video.